the one place in the Bible. We went over that in study tonight. I have a great pastor. I really do love my pastor. I toy with him a lot. I play with him, you know. I'm hoping he'll see what God is doing here. I just want him to open up his eyes and get it from God, not from me. I want his relationship with God to be improved. I want everybody's relationship with God to be improved. Trust God. Trust his word. He doesn't fail you. He doesn't falter. And so this finding, you know, when God says his thoughts are high above our thoughts, and is, you know, let's think higher thoughts. Let's just think God thoughts. You know, right? The enemy wanted to play king of the hill. Adam and Eve wanted to play hide and seek. God was all on that, on board with that. You know, get outside the garden, get out of the garden, get out of the garden. I'm going to curse the whole world for your sake, for the sake of the world, for the sake of man. He curses the whole world. Why? It's his time to go hide. But he's judged creation as unworthy of heaven. That's why we have 39 Old Testament books and 27 New Testament books. But in the New Testament, he tells us how we can have relationship, how we can be restored, renewed, reconciled. God doesn't want to save your water, doesn't want to save your vegetation, doesn't want to, you know, and he wants you to see where free will leads to rebellion and destruction, so that he can show you that, see, isn't it better if you love my son? Isn't it better when you worship my son? Isn't it better to know my son, who is the cornerstone of the whole new creation? Jesus Christ, the cornerstone, the one that the builders rejected. But my problem was, when I first got saved, was what church do I go to? That's why the one world leader brings about one world church, so that those that are lost in the world can find Christ. Right? Now, we don't have to lose our denominations. I'm not going to tell the Baptist to become Methodist. I'm not going to tell Methodist to become Baptist. What I'm going to do is to see to it that those who are preaching the Word of God, who love Jesus Christ, who worship and honor Christ, and do not allow paganism, nor do they allow the angel-eating wafer kind of thing happening in their churches, don't do that. Because, well, the angels really don't like being mocked. They don't like seeing God mocked. And you're not really receiving Christ in that kind of thing. Jesus said to do this in remembrance of me. He didn't say it is me. The enemy just does that over and over and over in the sacrifice because he didn't have a TiVo. So it's one sacrifice for all. Remember, Moses struck the rock twice. He was only asked to speak to the rock the second time, and its waters would pour forth. All God's asking you, once you've received Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, all you've got to do is speak to him, and his waters come forth. And being born again means to be born again in the Spirit. You don't have, don't take, and again, pastor, right on the money, 100% accurate. You know, you got to be fed by the spiritual milk of the Word. You're growing up for the new creation, the new heaven, new earth. Your mind is being renewed, so you're thinking God thoughts, godly things. You didn't have any interest in God before you were born again. Now you're born again, and all you want to do is build and work for the kingdom of God, for the work of the kingdom. You're on fire for the kingdom. And now you drink the spiritual milk of the Word. You read the Word. You renew your mind by the reading of God's Word, so that when the enemy comes up against you, you can quote Scripture against him. See, that's what Jesus did. When Jesus was tempted in the wilderness, he went out and he used the Word of God, and he spoke out against the enemy. When the enemy came to him and said, "It is written," Jesus said, "Well, no, it is also written that man shall not live by bread alone." And Lucifer came up to him and said, if you are the Son of God, turn the stone into bread. He is 40 days, he's hungry. And Jesus said, "It is written," you know. And then the devil misquoted the scriptures and said, "Well, you know, if, you know, it's written that you dive off the, you know, highest peak here, and he'll give his angels charge over thee." Well, that's, you know, he misquoted. He took it out of its context. But Jesus corrected him. "It is also written, thou shalt not tempt the Lord thy God." Another interesting fact here is that the Bible says that when a man is corrected, when a wise man is corrected, he thanks the person who corrected him. If you see a man going the wrong way and he's a wise man and you correct him, he thanks you for that. The devil will never thank you for correcting him. Jesus corrected him. Jesus wasn't expecting any kind of thank you from him. But see, if I've got something wrong, brothers and sisters in Christ, and you come and you correct me on that error, I will love you enough to thank you for it. That's what a wise man will do. He will thank you for that correction. I'm not perfect. I'm not going to sit here and tell you I'm perfect. I'm not here going to tell you my way is you know, because the Word of God is not up for private interpretation. But let us not rebuke wisdom. Let us not rebuke light. Let us not rebuke the Word being opened up for the world to see. Let us not come against that. I'm not telling you that there's any other way to God other than through Christ and through the cross. That's the only way you're going to get there. That's a truth. That's a truth. The Bible says you'll know the voice of your father. The father's voice will speak to your heart. The elect cannot be deceived. The voice of God will resonate within your heart. You'll be drawn to truth. They didn't come to Christ because he was beautiful looking or good looking. They came to Christ because he spoke truth. He revealed and opened up the scriptures to them. He told them what it was about. And now we're coming to the end. Now you need to know what it's really, really, really all about. One man, he rises up. And how does this one man rise up out of the earth? It's not because he's a political influence. He's a spiritual influence. He wants to bring the world together. He's a man of peace. What is the only peace plan that the world could ever have? It's in the gospel. It's in the Bible from Genesis to Revelation. No other book contains God's heart. No other book contains God's peace plan. The world needs a peace plan. And you're not going to find it in the Quran. You're not going to find it in the Book of Mormon. You're not going to find it in Hank Hanegraaff's books. You're not going to find it at the film festival. You're not going to find it. The peace plan of God is written from Genesis to Revelation. It's rightly dividing the Word of God. It's rightly bringing it in together to bring it all under Christ. And how do you bring the world, the whole world, under Christ so that when we cry peace and safety, we're crying peace and safety? He quoted the Word. So if you don't have the Word in you, then you cannot fight this creature, this invisible force that's around us. And that's what's destroying this world, is this invisible force. But God went and dressed it, put clothes on it. You know, those hats that they get out there in Rome, they're not cheap. You don't get those at Kmart. They suck the wealth of the world right away from the masses. And now they're responsible for the creation of the mark. The banking system is sucking the wealth out of the world. They want you in debt. They want you to be their slaves. And what they're going to do is when all the wealth of we become a cashless society, they're going to try and bag and tag you. And God says, whoever takes the mark on their right hand or on their forehead will never enter into the kingdom of God, because what you'll be saying is that you want to be planted into the matrix. You want to remain part of this satanic system. Because you love the material goods, the material possessions. Just remember, God created the heavens and the earth, and he's waiting for you to come home where he has much better things in store for you. But if you fall in love with this world, then the love of the Father is not in you. Don't live for this world. This world is temporal. This world is temporary. Tomorrow you could be in a car accident. Next week you could be shot by some kind of moron who thinks that, you know, his video game has become reality for him.
Your world could end with a big bang. Have you made peace with God? Visit www.bookofabel.com. That's all one word, bookofabel.com.
Everybody leaves this world in the same way that they came in, with nothing. They may put clothes on you and put you in a casket and put you in the ground, or they may cremate you, but you leave this world with nothing. You only leave with what you've learned. And if you've not accepted Christ, if you've not accepted the Son of God, if you didn't want to be part of his creation, he's not going to force you. See, this is a way station. He's weighing the heart of his creation. We're not worthy to enter into the kingdom of God. He has judged his creation unworthy of his kingdom. That the only way that you can get into his kingdom is through the blood of his Son, through the cross. He has judged sin. Sin is not allowed in heaven. Why? Because it wouldn't be heaven. If we let everybody think, oh, he's died, he's in a much better place. If he didn't talk about Christ, if he didn't go to church, if he didn't worship God, if he didn't speak about God, Jesus says, if you confess me before men, I will confess you before my Father in heaven. If you deny me before men, I will deny you before my Father in heaven. If his works did not say that he was working to live in heaven, if he wasn't working to live in heaven, he's not living in heaven. Do you capisce? Does that comprehend? He came in naked, he left naked. And if he didn't go to be one of, if he wasn't being with God, if he didn't want to be with his creator on this side of the veil, he isn't going to be on the, with the, because we're not allowing wicked to come in. Because heaven wouldn't be heaven if you let people just do their own thing and do their own will. God's looking for you to conform to his will. And his will says that if you don't come through the cross, you're not getting in. You can't play nice with God's child on the outside of the house. We're not letting you into the house. It's simple as that. I don't want God made hell for me so that I don't have to have evil and wickedness and violence in my life anymore. I'm tired of it. I don't want it in my life. I don't like it. So hell was made to protect me from wicked individuals, from rebellious individuals, from people who would just torment you and cause you pain and suffering. I don't need that in heaven. If you can't get it right on this side, well, let me tell you something. The devil can't create. Go back to read the rich man and Lazarus. The rich man doesn't have a name because his name was written in the book of life. But he's there dead, and now he's looking up and he's seeing Lazarus in the bosom of Abraham. And what is he doing to Lazarus? He's still treating him like he's a slave, because people who die in the spiritual sense continue to go on and exist like they existed on earth, only caring about what they want, not caring about what other people want or caring about other people at all. It's about them. It's me, 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 me. What's in it for me? I made my confirmation. I made my communion. Me, 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 me. I did this. I did that. Me, 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 me. Never giving God any credit for anything. Oh, I don't need God. Well, how the hell do you breathe? When you reach in a fridge, what are you reaching for? Why even open the door? You don't need anything. You don't need God. You live fine without him. Until you die, and then you're begging. Get some water on my tongue. Oh, I'm hot. I'm hot suffering here. Oh, please help me. Help me. You know? And that's all hell is just begging for the mercy of God. When you could have had his mercy, you could have had his gift. You didn't want his gift. You rejected his gift. You rejected his son. But you want him to accept you when you rejected him? It ain't happening. You're barking up the wrong tree. You know, oh, God isn't everything. Oh, God, God's a God of love. He doesn't create bad places. Yet, have you ever been in a tsunami? Have you ever been bitten by bees or stung by bees? Have you ever, fire ants? Have you ever been burnt? You know, have you ever had your heart broken? Oh, God's a God of love. He wouldn't create bad things. Bad things wouldn't happen. Oh. Obviously, you don't live in reality. Obviously, you don't live at all. You're dead to the world. You're dead. And so God wants to bring you to life. He wants to quicken you. He wants to make you alive and get you ready for the new heavens and the new earth. And he's not taking people that, oh, God, hug a tree. Love this, love that. Oh, you Christians, you think you're so smart. You think you're so much better than the rest of us. Well, that's the way God made it. And if you can't get along with his children on the outside of his house nice, you're not coming in the house nice.